वेलकम एवरीवन टू द कंटिन्यूशन ऑफ आवर सीरीज ऑन वेक्टर्स। सो इन द लास्ट लेक्चर वी डिस्कस्ड हाउ टू ऐड मल्टीपल वेक्टर्स ज्योमेट्रिकली एंड एनालिटिकली। सो इन दिस लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू बिल्ड अपॉन दैट आइडिया। सो फर्स्ट वी आर गोइंग टू सी हाउ डू वी सब्सट्रैक्ट टू वेक्टर्स। The subtraction of two vectors, let's say A vector and B vector, is done by reversing the vector which we want to subtract. So here we want to subtract vector B. So what we will be doing is that K will be reversing B vector, and after reversing B vector, we simply add A with minus B. So we have a vector A. And we have the vector B after reversing it. So we have reverse vector B, and this is the vector A. So if we add A and minus B, so we would get A minus B vector. So this is subtraction of a vector from another vector. So A minus B from triangle rule of vector addition would be this, joining the remaining tail and head in the direction from tail to head. So this is A plus minus B, that is A minus B. Okay. Next, we have some standard questions. Can three non-zero coplanar vectors add up to zero vector? So let's say in the plane of this screen, I have drawn the vector this one, and this one. So let's say the angle between these two vectors is 90 degree. So this angle is some 90. This side is 3, this side is 4, and let's say this is 5. Then we know that K vectors 3 and 4 when added can give us 5 vectors. So these are 3 coplanar vectors, and their sum can be 0. Now, in subtraction of vectors, we want to see that like this is analogous to what we do in simple algebra also. For example, we want to subtract 10 and 9 from 10. So we reverse 9, that is we put a negative sign in front of 9 and add it with 10, so we get 1. So we have done the same here. When we have written A minus B, we have simply added a negative sign in front of B and then added it to A vector. Then A minus B becomes this, what we require. Okay, so after doing this one, can three non-zero non-coplanar vectors add up to zero? So let's say I have drawn some x-axis, some y-axis, and some z-axis. So vector number one is this one, vector number two, and this is vector number 3. So if we add any two of these three vectors, let's say I have added this x, the vector along x axis, with the vector along z axis, so we get some vector of this kind. So this vector is definitely in xz plane, and it is neither in xy plane nor in yz plane. That means that it can never be along y axis, in which our third vector is. So this vector and this vector can never cancel out. So since any two vectors form a unique plane of own, and by saying that the three vectors are non-coplanar, the third vector is automatically out of plane of the first two vectors, and because of which when we add these two vectors we get a vector which is out of plane of the third vector, and this vector being out of plane can never add up to zero. So three non-zero non-coplanar vectors can never add up to zero. The answer to this question would be no. Okay. So now, after discussing a lot about how to add two vectors, how to draw a vector, how to represent a vector, now we want to write a vector in such a way that we understand it. That is, for example, we write a algebraic number 5, 4, 10, 11, 99. So in the same way, we want to write a vector. So the next part of our discussion would be that how to write a vector. How do we write a vector? So we write vector using what we have already learned. So we have learned that we have I cap, j cap, k cap. Now we remember these are the unit vectors which are fixed and they are along x, y and z axis. So I cap is a unit vector along x axis, j cap is a unit vector along y axis, and k cap is a unit vector along z axis. So all these unit vectors can be used to form vectors along respective axes. So we have done that only. What we have done is that we have drawn an OX vector. And this OX vector is purely along X axis. Since it is along X axis, I can use I cap to write this vector. So the magnitude of this vector is X, and it is along X axis. So I have written I cap and put a coefficient x beside it. So x is the magnitude of this vector and I cap is the direction of the vector. So this OX vector becomes x I cap. Next, I want to write the vector along y axis. So this would be a vector along y-axis. As you can see in the figure, the magnitude of this particular length is y, and this is along j-cap, so yj-cap. Similarly for z, like we have done for x, the length of this particular side is x, and it is along x-axis, so it is xi-cap. For z-axis, the length is z, and it is along z-axis, that means it is zk-cap. Now these three vectors, OX vector, OY vector and OZ vector, all these vectors have to be added. So we would add them one by one. So we have chosen XZ plane. So in XZ plane, we have vector OX and OZ. So these two vectors, OX and OZ, in this particular rectangle, when added, give the diagonal of the rectangle. So the diagonal of the rectangle is something like this. This is the diagonal of this rectangle. So as we can see that OX and OZ, when added, they give OA. So OA vector is equal to OX, which is XI cap, and OZ, which is z k cap. Now actually I want this point to be very clear, so I will repeat it. This ox vector we have already written x I cap, and oz vector that also I have already written, that is z k cap. So in the rectangle which is at the base of this cuboid, if we want to add the sides of the rectangle, so this side is ox, this side is oz. So when we add these two sides, ox and oz, we get the diagonal like we used to study the diagonal in the case of a parallelogram. So rectangle is also a parallelogram, and we knew that okay, the diagonal which we have to study is the one which starts from the common point. So this is the diagonal which starts from the common point. So ox plus oz, when added, they give you this diagonal. This diagonal is OA vector because this point is marked as A. So this OA vector is equal to xi plus zk cap. Now the remaining vector is OY vector. So the in the plane containing OY, OA and Y axis, OA and Y axis, that is the that is actually how we cut the cuboid along its diagonal. If we were to cut the cuboid along its diagonal, we would get a plane YPAO. So in this plane we have two vectors, one vector is OA vector and the other vector is OY. So this OA vector we have already found what it is. This OY vector we have already written, it is YJ cap. So if you would imagine, now let's take imagination to a non-theoretical idea. Let's say you have a room. So in that room, this is the floor which we have already studied. So the diagonally opposite points of the floor are OA, and the bottommost point, this point O, and the point just above it, let's say which is on the ceiling, is Y. So the point joining the diagonal, this particular line, and the height of the room, when these two vectors are added, you would get a vector which is the body diagonal. That means it joins the vertices of the cuboid which are the farthest from each other. So this would be pretty easy to imagine. For example, you want to travel in the shortest path from one vertex to the opposite vertex. Then that particular path would be this body diagonal. So this body diagonal can be achieved by using the phase diagonal which we already found, and using this height of the room. So this vector is what we are aiming at, OP vector, the body diagonal vector. So let's move ahead. This OP vector is definitely OA plus OY, which we already discussed. So OA vector is XI plus ZK and OY vector is YJ. Rearranging them, we get OP vector equal to XI plus Y, this is Y, J cap and Z k cap. So this whole vector OP vector, which is the body diagonal of the room which we imagined, or which is the body diagonal of the cuboid which we can see in this figure, this OP vector is called the position vector of the point P. Where point P was what? Point P was a coordinate of this cuboid whose coordinates were X, Y and Z. So the position vector represents the position of a point P, which is x, y, z, on the edge of the cuboid as a vector. That means the objective of the position vector is to represent that point as a vector. The point was x, y, z, which we already know. For example, we have a point x, y in space. So how do we represent that as a vector? So we put I cap and J cap beside it. So in the same way, we have x, y, z. So how do we write a point as a vector? To write point as a vector, we do is that we put I cap, J cap and K cap besides the x, y and z. So when we put these values as shown, so we get the position vector of the point. So to clarify what we have said, we take an example. We have to represent point P, which is 2, 3, 4.5 as a position vector. So the value of x here is 2, the value of y is 3, and the value of z is 4.5. So the position vector OP becomes xi, which is 2i cap, yj, that is 3j cap, and zk, that is 4.5 k cap. So this is the position vector for this point. So in conclusion, we can say that we have converted the position x, y, and z into a vector. So it is a way of representing that point as a vector, and it is also a way to write a vector. That was our objective, how to write a vector. So this is how we write a vector. This is a vector. The coordinates x, y, z are called the components of the vector OP along x, y, and z axis respectively. Okay. This line means that when we draw a vector, like OP vector drawn here, so x, y, and z are the components of the vector OP along x, y, and z axis. Now, by components, we mean that if we draw a perpendicular from point P to x axis, the length of the foot of that perpendicular, that means this particular distance would be the component x. In the same way, if I would draw a perpendicular from point P to the y axis, then this particular length would be the y component. So these components x, y, and in the same way, if I were to draw for z axis, then again this particular distance, that is the distance from the foot to the origin, this distance would be z. So these are the components, that is drawing a perpendicular from the point P to the x-axis, and then measuring the length of the foot of the perpendicular from the starting point of the vector. So that is the origin. So we have taken again an example that, let's say OP vector is some 40i plus 60j. Then what will be my components? So we know that the x component is the thing beside I cap. So this is x, and this is the x component of the vector. And the y component of the vector is the thing beside j cap. So the coefficient of j cap, that is 60, this is y, and this is also the y component. So this is what is written here. The component of OP along x axis is equal to 40 unit. The component of OP along y axis is equal to 60 unit. So let's say I have drawn OP vector here, and this is a xy plane, and I have drawn a perpendicular from point P to x axis. So this is OP vector, and from OP vector I draw a perpendicular on x axis. So this is the perpendicular which I want to draw. So this is the perpendicular I have drawn on the x axis, and this is the perpendicular I have drawn on the y axis. So what we said is that if we draw a perpendicular from the tip of the vector to some axis, then the distance of the foot of the perpendicular from the point where it started, this particular distance is the component of the vector along that particular axis. That is simply the x coordinate of the point P. So the x coordinate of the point P was 40. That means this particular length is 40, which we already know. In the same way, when we drop a perpendicular from point P on the y axis, the distance from the foot of the perpendicular to this particular origin. This particular distance is the y component, and this y component is equal to y. So we already know this particular distance is 60. So we have drawn 60 here. So that means that if we want to get to the point P, we have to travel x distance, some 40 unit distance along x axis, and then next to it we have to travel 60 unit distance along y axis, and we will achieve point P. And this particular distance which we have to travel to get to point P eventually becomes the components of the point of the vector OP along x axis and y axis. So we would learn more about components in further topics, but summarizing what we have learned here is that if we have a vector, let's say xi plus yj, then simply the x and y values are called the components of the vector along the respective axis. So suppose we have written xi cap plus yj cap, then this value x, this is the x component of the vector, and this is the y component of the vector. So if this particular bit is clear to you, then one more term which we use to describe this x and y is called projections. That means when we draw a projection of OP vector on x axis, then that particular projection is the x component. So what do we mean by the projection? Projection, we simply say that imagine that this is a rod lying on a table, a rod lying leaning against a wall. So this is the wall which we are talking about, this particular wall, and this is the rod. And there is a light positioned above the wall. There is a light which is falling like this. So what would be the shadow produced by this light? So the shadow produced by this light is called the projection of this length on this surface. So this shadow which we are producing, this is called projection. And this projection is called the x component because it is on the x surface. Similarly, if we were to produce the shadow in by this light, the shadow would fall on y axis. So this shadow would be called the y component. So this is what we call the projection of a vector along some particular axis. Next, how to write a vector whose magnitude and angle are. Now, in the previous topic, we learned how to write a vector if we know that what are the coordinates of the point which we are going to write about. Suppose we knew x and y. So we simply wrote a vector xi cap plus yj cap. So this is how we wrote a vector. It's pretty easy to write. But what if these coordinates are not known? And instead what is given is that okay, this vector is this much big and this vector is making this much angle, like you can see in the figure. It is written that this particular vector is some r length long, and this vector makes an angle theta with the x-axis. So what we want to do is that we want to write this vector, and that is the question and that is the topic, how to write a vector when its magnitude and angle which it makes with any of the axes is given. So in this particular case, we have taken an xy plane. A vector of magnitude r makes an angle theta with the x-axis. Question is, write this vector. So this is a common idea which we have to learn, that how to write a vector when in this situation. It's not as such that this is some topic that we are learning something new. What we are doing is that we already know a lot about vectors. We know unit vectors. We know that if there is a point, then how to write that vector xi cap plus yj cap, which is like the easiest thing ever. So now what we want to know is that if some other vector is described in some different way, it is written in its magnitude and the angle it is making. So what is the easiest way to proceed? So this problem would come again and again. So we want to generalize how to do this problem, and we skip to the important part of the questions. So what we have done is that we have chosen a vector whose magnitude is r and it makes an angle theta with the x-axis. The length Ox is the component of OP vector along x-axis. So this is written here. So this is what we discussed in the previous topic, that if we take the projection of OP or drop of perpendicular of OP, this particular length is the component. So we want to write Ox. So to write Ox, we would require a bit of trigonometry. So what we do is that we take a ratio. So we know that in a triangle, base of the triangle divided by the hypotenuse is equal to cos theta. From that we can say that Ox is equal to r cos theta. Similarly, we can write Oy is equal to r sin theta. So we have written this side and we have written this side. So we know that if we add Ox and Oy, we would get OP. Ox can be written as r cos theta I cap, and Oy can be written as r sin theta j cap. That means this particular vector is some r cos theta I cap, this is r sin theta j cap. If we add these two vectors, we get OP. So this is what this we have tried to write here, r cos theta I cap plus r sin theta j cap. This is OP vector. So if we know the magnitude of a vector and we know the angle which the vector makes with the posterior direction of x axis in anti-clockwise sense, then that vector can be written as r cos theta I cap plus r sin theta j cap. So this would be a very common formula which you would use. And next, what we have done is that we have taken r common from this whole expression. So we have taken r outside. This term becomes cos theta I cap plus sin theta j cap, and r is common. R is the magnitude of the vector. So this we already know how long that vector is the magnitude of the vector. And we know that when we are writing a vector, and that is equal to magnitude of vector into something, then that something must be the direction of the vector. That means the magnitude of the vector into the direction of the vector is the vector. So we know that r is the magnitude of the vector. That means the thing beside it should be the direction of the vector. So the direction of the vector comes out to be cos theta I cap plus sin theta j cap. Now first, this formula is again similar to the previous one, and it's also important. So and after proceeding, what we can say is that this is a direction vector. A direction vector by definition have a magnitude equal to 1 because they are unit vectors. So if you check it, which you can do at home, the magnitude of this particular vector would be 1. So the natural question would come in your mind is that can I write direction of any vector using this? The answer would be absolutely. You have to write any 2D vector in this form only. That means if you know that that vector makes an angle theta with the x-axis in the anticlockwise sense, then the direction of that vector has to be equal to cos theta I cap plus sin theta j cap. And when that is multiplied with the magnitude of the vector, would give you the complete vector OP. So to demonstrate what we have said, we have taken a simple example that this is a small vector r and we want to write it. So this vector r is 5√2 meters long, or 5√2 unit long, and it makes an angle of 45° with the posterior direction of x-axis in anti-clockwise sense. So this is important, anti-clockwise sense. So r vector is equal to the magnitude of vector, which is simply 5√2. Into cos theta cos 45i plus sin 45j. So this is r vector. If we open cos 45 degree, cos 45 is 1 by root 2, and similarly for sine 45, root 2 would be cancelled out and r vector would come out to be 5i plus 5j. Now we can verify this using our manual calculation also. This particular length is 5 root 2. That means this length, that is the component wala length, is equal to 5 root 2 cos 45 degree. 5 root 2 cos 45 is 5, and similarly this particular length would also come out to be 5 root 2 sine 45 degree, because the side in front of theta is sine side, so 5 root 2 sine 45 degree. This is also 5. That means 5y plus 5j should be the vector which also which came out to be the answer. So this means that this is a short way of writing it. We took another example in which we have taken obtuse angle. So the magnitude of the vector is now 10, and we want to write the vector. So the magnitude of the vector into cos 120 degree I cap plus sine 120 degree j cap. Now we take the next, go to the next line. Cos 120 is minus 1 upon 2. So minus 1 upon 2 I cap plus sine 120, which is root 3 by 2 j cap. So 2 is taken common, it comes out to be minus 5 I cap plus 5 root 3 j cap. So this vector gives us some information about the whereabouts of the vector. That means in which direction the vector is going to be. For example, the vector here is along negative direction of the x-axis. That means that the vector should go somewhere along negative x direction. And if its y component is positive, that means the vector must go along some positive y direction of the x-axis. So we say that this vector gives us some information as to where it is going. So this vector comes out to be minus 5y plus 5 root 3 j. Next, we have a question. Write the following forces in vector form. So these are all forces, 10 Newton, 10 Newton, 10 Newton, 6 Newton. We have to write it in vector form. That means we have to put some I cap, j cap in front of it. That is the objective of the question. We are expert in writing I cap and j cap by now. If we know the coordinate of the vector, we simply, for example, x, y is the coordinate of the vector, then the vector would have been x I cap plus y j cap. But now what is happening is that we know the magnitude of the vector. So we have to use cos theta I plus sin theta j into the magnitude of the vector. Here the vector is making no angle. That means it's purely 10 Newton I cap, or you can say 10 I cap Newtons. This is the case similar to the previous one, 120 degree case. So we would write 10 Newton cos 150 I cap plus sine 150 j cap. So this comes out to be 10 Newton. Cos 150 is equal to minus root 3 by 2 I cap, and sine 150 is equal to half j cap. So this would be part would come out to be, let's write its answer over here. As we are constrained for space, minus 5 root 3 I plus 5 j. So this is this vector. So how about for next part, we do not use the formula which we have learned. We try to write the vector manually. So what do you mean by that? By that we mean that we want to write the individual components. And by components we simply mean that what is the projection of 10 Newton on its x-axis. So let's write it. So this projection would be this particular length. So this is 10 Newton. We are taking the foot of the perpendicular, and this is the projection. So this is 10 cos 45 degree, and this is 10 sine 45. So 10 sine 45 degree is equal to 5 root 2, and 10 cos 45 degree is also 5 root 2. And both these components are all on negative x-axis and negative y-axis. So when we were to write this vector, let's say this vector is some r. So r vector would be equal to 5 root 2 and it is along which direction? It is along negative x axis. So minus 5 root 2 I cap. So we are done with the x component part. Next we would take the y component part. So the y component part is again 5 root 2 and it is along negative y axis. So we have used the sign negative, minus 5 root 2 and the unit vector along y axis is j cap. So this is r vector. Next we want to write this vector 6 newton. So 6 newton is computed along x axis and y axis, the r vector. So 6 newton along x axis, this particular distance is simply 6 cos 60 degree and this distance would be 6 sine 60 degree. So the side which is along theta, which is adjacent to theta, is called the cos theta side, and the side which is in front of theta is called sine 60 side. So this is called 6 cos 60, this is 6 sine 60. 6 cos 60 is along positive direction of x axis. So we write 6 cos 60 degree I cap plus and 6 sine 60 degree along minus y axis. So 6 sine 60 degree minus j cap as it is along the negative x axis. 6 cos 60 degrees is equal to 3, 6 sine 60 degrees is equal to minus 3 root 3 j cap. So this is r vector. So this is how we write a vector when its magnitude and its direction with some axis is given. Okay, moving on. Next we have magnitude of a vector. So if we are given a vector, what is its magnitude? Let's say x I cap plus y j cap plus z k cap. So if we know the magnitude of the vector, then the expression to be used is that magnitude of the vector into cos theta and plus sine theta j. But if we do not know the magnitude, if we are given the coordinates x, y, z, then what is the magnitude of the vector? The magnitude of the vector would be simply the length of that body diagonal which we saw, the length of the OP vector. The length of the OP vector is simply root x square plus y square plus z square. And similarly for 2D, this is xi plus yj. The magnitude of r would be x square plus y square. So these are again very important expression. And what is the magnitude of vector? The magnitude of vector is if xi plus yj is given, then simply square root x square plus y square, which is Pythagoras theorem. Next, we want to write the direction of a vector. So direction of a vector would be again calculated using the formula which we saw. That means the whole idea behind vector hinges behind the formula that how do we get a vector. The vector is basically, we want to write the vector r. The r vector is basically the magnitude of the vector into the direction of the vector, which is a unit vector. So if we want to write the direction of a vector r cap, so we have to divide the vector with the magnitude of the vector. So this is what we have done here. We have divided the magnitude of the vector and we got the direction of the vector. So this direction of the vector is now written in this way. So what we have done is that xi plus yj plus zk, that is divided by the magnitude of r, which we know as square root of x square plus y square plus z square. So we have distributed square root. we have distributed the square root. It is beneath each and every coefficient. So this is x upon under root x square plus y square, y upon under root x square plus y square plus z square, and z upon under root x square plus y square plus z square k cap. So this is how we write a direction of vector. Now, what if we have a 2D vector, there is no j cap. So in that case, r cap would be simply x upon under root x square plus y square I cap plus y upon under root x square plus y square j cap. So that would be the direction of a vector where we are facing a 2D situation. So next, what do these coefficients signify? And by coefficients we mean that the thing beside the terms besides I cap, J cap, and K cap. The coefficients x, y, and z in R cap are called direction cosines of R vector along x, y, and z axis. So the coefficient of I cap, this whole term, this is called direction cosine along x axis. This j cap and its coefficient, this coefficient is called a direction cosine along y axis. So the coefficient of I cap and j cap are called direction cosines. So what do we mean by direction cosine? Now, by direction cosine we mean that imagine that same vector OP. Now that OP vector was x cap plus y cap, yj cap plus zk cap. Now that vector would be making some angles alpha, beta and gamma with the x, y and z axis. This is what is written here also. Okay, if alpha, beta and gamma are the angles which R vector makes with x, y and z axis. So these angles can be investigated using these direction cosines. So what we do is that, now it is already written here, what are these? These are direction cosines. So that means that this whole term, that is x upon under root x square plus y square plus z square, this is actually the cosine of the direction. And the direction is angle alpha. That means the vector makes an angle alpha with the x axis. So this term is cos alpha. That means it is cos of the angle which the vector makes with the x axis. So this is what you would see here. Cos alpha is equal to x upon under root x square plus y square plus z square. In the same way, we want to write cos beta. So cos beta is equal to y upon under root x square plus y square plus z square, and cos gamma is equal to z upon under root x square plus y square plus z square. So these coefficients are simply cos alpha, cos beta and cos gamma. So common identity comes associated with the direction cosines, that cos square alpha plus cos square beta plus cos square gamma equal to 1. Okay, next. So we have a question. A vector is equally inclined on x, y, and z axis in a coordinate system. Find cos alpha. So this means that the vector is making equal angles with all the axes. That means alpha, beta and gamma are equal. So from this particular identity we can extend that cos square alpha plus cos square alpha plus cos square alpha. That means cos square alpha times 3 is equal to 1. So cos alpha would come out to be plus minus 1 by 2. So this is what we wanted to find. Next, we have addition slash subtraction of vectors. So how do we add two vectors? So A vector and B vector can be added, and these, and what we do is that we add the respective I cap components and J cap components. So suppose we want to add these two vectors, so the I cap component of A vector and B vector are added. So we get A1 plus B1 I cap, and the components of J cap are A2 and B2. It's A2 plus B2 J cap. Similarly, we want to subtract B from A. So their respective components are simply subtracted. So A1 minus B1 I cap. A2 minus B2 J cap. Suppose that we want to add two vectors like 2i plus 3j and 4i plus j. We want to add these two vectors. So the respective x components would be added. So we would get 2 plus 4, 6i and 3 plus 1, that is 4j. So this would be a plus b. Is it possible that A plus B is less than A minus B? If so, under what condition? This is absolutely possible. Suppose that we use the draw vectors like these. So here A plus B vector would give you this vector. So this vector is here. This is A plus B. And now we want to find A minus B, right? So we reverse A vector. A minus B, so we would be reversing B. So we have reversed B vector, A minus B. So A plus minus B. So as you can see, when we are adding A and B, we got this vector A plus B. To find A minus B, we have reversed B vector. So we have got minus B vector. And when we are adding A with minus B, we get this vector. So clearly, in this particular situation, when the angle between A and B was obtuse, this particular angle was obtuse, the sum of these two vectors A plus B is slightly lesser than when we add or subtract these two vectors. That is A minus B, this vector is significantly longer than this vector. So it is absolutely possible that A minus B is more than A plus B. Next idea is that under what conditions? The conditions have to be the angle between A and B has to be more than 90 degrees. Okay, moving on. So after adding and subtracting any two vectors, we want to multiply two vectors. So multiplication of two vectors can be done in two ways. The first is called scalar product. and the second is called vector product. So as the name suggests, in scalar product, the quantity which would come out of multiplication of two vectors is going to be a scalar, and in vector product, the quantity which is going to come out is going to be a vector. So what is a scalar product? So yeah, let's say we have two vectors A and B, like we have drawn here, vector A and vector B. So what we do is that we take the projection of the first vector on the second vector. So that is also included in its definition, as the multiplication of projection of the first vector on another, that means the second vector. That is the second vector and the magnitude of the second vector. So this is the second vector. So the projection of first vector on the second vector and the magnitude of the second vector. So these two quantities are multiplied. That is A cos theta into B. So A cos theta into B, when rearranged, it gives us AB cos theta. And this AB cos theta is equal to A dot B. So this is called the scalar product or the dot product of the vectors A and B, where A was the first vector, its projection was taken on the second vector A cos theta, and it was multiplied with the magnitude of the second vector B. So this is AB cos theta. Okay, now from the definition B dot A, let's say we want to find B dot A. So here the first vector is B, and we take the projection of the first vector B on the second one. So that would be again B cos theta. And like the projection of first vector on the second was A cos theta, projection of second on first would also be B cos theta, multiplied with the magnitude of second vector A. So this is B cos theta into A, which is same as AB cos theta. So we can say that A dot B is equal to B dot A. So revisiting what we have learned, dot product of two vectors whose magnitudes are A and B, and the angle between whom is theta, is simply A into B into cos theta. It is a scalar quantity, as there is no I cap J cap associated with this, the final product, it's a scalar quantity, and that's why it's called a scalar product. And it also follows a simple rule, just like we learned in maths, like 1 into 2 is equal to 2 into 1. In the same way, A dot B is equal to A dot A. Next, we have taken an example. The vector A is some 2 units long, and vector B is some 4 units long. The angle between A and B is equal to 60 degrees. And we have to find A dot B. So what is A dot B? So A dot B is equal to magnitude of A, which is 2, magnitude of B, which is 4, and cos of the angle between A and B, which is 60 degrees. So this would come out to be 4. That means A dot B is 4. Scalar product of two vectors is a scalar quantity, and is thus not associated with any direction. There is no direction associated with a scalar product, so it's a scalar quantity. A dot A is equal to A square into cos of the angle which A vector makes with A vector. The angle between two A vectors is 0, so cos 0. So A square into cos 0 is equal to A square into cos 0, which is 1, so this is A square. So that means taking dot product with itself would achieve nothing but the square of the magnitude of the vector. So for example, we have gone to take I dot I. So I dot I is equal to j is equal to k is equal to the magnitude of this vector, which is 1, the square, which is 1 itself. That means I dot I is equal to j is equal to k is equal to 1. So this is a very important thing to learn. Next, what if we want to take dot product of two vectors which are perpendicular to each other? If two vectors are perpendicular to each other or orthogonal, as the word is written here, then their dot product is zero. So why is that? It is simply because of the fact that we have a cos or theta term, and when the angle between the two vectors becomes 90, then cos 90 becomes zero. So no matter what the magnitude of the vectors were, since cos theta term is zero, that means the whole scalar product collapses to zero, and that means that the dot product becomes zero. So that means any two vectors, no matter how big or small, their dot product would be zero if the angle between them is 90. Next, if I dot j is to be calculated, j dot k, k dot I, all these are to be zero. Next, we want to find if there are two general vectors given, a vector and b vector, then what is their dot product? So a vector is equal to a1 I cap plus a2 j cap plus a3 k cap. B vector is equal to b1 I plus b2 j plus b3 k cap. Now we want to take dot product of these two vectors. So what we do? So we know that I dot I is 1, j dot j is 1, k dot k is 1. I dot j is 0, I dot k is 0, j dot I is 0, j dot k is 0. So when we are to multiply three terms with three terms, we would get total 9 terms. And among these 9 terms, 6 terms would be those in which we are multiplying two vectors perpendicular to each other. That means the terms would be like I dot j or I dot k or k dot I. So those 6 terms would be 0, and the 3 terms would be not 0, would be I dot I, j dot j and k dot k. So a1 I cap and b1 I cap. When we take dot product of these two things, we get a1 b1 plus j dot j. j dot j would be 1, so a2 plus k dot k. K dot k would also be 1, so this would be a3 b3. So a dot j is equal to a1 b1 plus a2 b2 plus a3 b3. So this is dot product of two vectors which are given in xyz form. Next, we want to calculate how to find an angle between any two vectors. So this is a very useful idea which would use in a lot of things. For example, two forces are given or two velocities are given. So what is the angle between these two velocities you want to find out when you want to visualize? Or in particular question, you are asked that, okay, this particle was moving in this direction at this particular time, and there was another particle which is moving in this particular direction in some other time. So what would be the angle between these two velocities at that time? So how do we do that? So for that, we have to fundamentally understand what the qualities were. So these two velocities were vector. So how to find angle between any two vectors? So what we do is that we take dot product of the two vectors. So a dot b. So a dot b is a1 b1 plus a2 b2 plus a3 b3. This we learned previously. Next, we take magnitude of the vectors. Magnitude of vector A and magnitude of vector B. Magnitude of vector A is square root of a1 square plus a2 square plus a3 square. Magnitude of vector B is square root of b1 square plus b2 square plus b3 square. So a dot b upon magnitude of A, magnitude of B. This whole term, what is this? So let us revisit the definition of dot product. A dot b is equal to magnitude of A, magnitude of B, cos theta, which is written here. So if you want to isolate cos theta can be written as A dot b divided by magnitude of A, magnitude of B. So when we have divided dot product with the magnitude of these two vectors, we are simply left with cos theta, which is written here. That cos theta is equal to a1 b1 plus a2 b2 plus so on, divided by square root of magnitude of A vector and square root of magnitude of B vector. So this is a big formula. But with use, we can learn it and it will be very useful. Example, find dot product of force and some displacement. force is given as 2i plus 3j, and displacement is given as 3r plus 4j. So we know that when multiplying, when taking dot product of two vectors, we simply multiply the coefficient of I cap and add them with coefficient multiplication of coefficients of the j cap. The I cap coefficient 2, I cap coefficient 3, these two are multiplied, 2 into 3 plus 3 into 4. So this would be it. Next, we want to take an example how to find angle between two vectors. So we have taken the vector A root 3i plus j cap and B vector equal to minus I cap. A dot B is what? So A dot B is I dot I. I dot I is 1. Root 3 into minus 1 is minus root 3. And here j cap is not there. So j cap would be, coefficient of j cap is 0. 0 into 1 would be 0. A dot B is equal to minus root 3. Magnitude of A vector is 2. Root 3 plus 1. So magnitude of A would be square of root 3 plus 1 square. Root 3 square is 3 plus 1. Root 4 is 2. So magnitude of A is equal to 2. Magnitude of B is equal to 1. Next, we use the formula, what is cos theta? The cos theta was A dot B, that is minus root 3, divided by the magnitude of the vector A and magnitude of vector B, 2 into 1, which is 2. So A dot B divided by A into B, which is 2. So minus root 3 by 2 is cos theta. Theta is equal to 120. So cos theta is equal to minus root 3 by 2. Then theta should be 150 degree, right? Yeah. So if cos theta is minus root 3 by 2, theta should be 150 degree. If cos theta was minus half, then theta would be 120. So if A is equal to 2, B is equal to 3, A dot B is equal to 3, this is given. Find magnitude of A plus B. So how do you find the magnitude of A plus B? So A dot B is equal to AB cos theta. So AB cos theta is given to us as 3, because we know that A dot B is equal to 3. AB cos theta is 3. The magnitude of A plus B is equal to A square plus B square plus 2AB cos theta. So AB cos theta is nothing but A dot B, which we already know. So A square, that is 2, is substituted here, 3 is substituted here, and A dot B is also substituted here. They get 4 plus 9 plus 2 into 3, which is simply root 9. Next, after the examples, we come on to the question. So we are given two vectors, vector A and vector B. So vector A is AI cap plus BJ cap, and vector E is equal to CI cap plus EJ cap. For non-zero values of A, B, C and D, find a condition using A, B, C and D such that A and E are orthogonal. That means using the variables in the vector, we have to ensure that vectors A and E are perpendicular to each other. So we have already learned that if two vectors are perpendicular to each other, then their dot product is 0. So let's take dot product of these two vectors. These two vectors, A, I cap coefficient is multiplied with I cap coefficient. A is multiplied with C, AC. Plus, J cap coefficient is multiplied with J cap coefficient. B is multiplied with D. B into D is equal to 0. This implies AC plus BD is 0, or simply AC equal to minus BD. So this is the condition which we were looking for. So if this condition is followed, we can know that A and E are perpendicular to each other. Are these two vectors parallel to each other? So we are given 9i plus 3j and 3i plus j. So here the question tells us specifically to use scalar puttup. What if we don't want to use it? So if we take common out of the vector A, let's say we have taken 3 common. The vector A is simply 3 times 3i plus j. If we take 3 common out of here, so A vector is 3 times this vector. And this vector is nothing but b. So that means A vector is equal to 3b. So we have formed A using b 3 times. So that means A and b have to be parallel to each other. But we are still not able to prove this using scalar product. Now, how do we prove using scalar product? So what we will do is that A, take magnitude of vector A. The magnitude of vector A is simply square root of 81 plus 9. That is root 90. Plus magnitude of vector B, which is root 10. A dot B. Is equal to 9 times 3, which is 27, plus 3 times 1, which is 3, is equal to 40. So, cos theta, which is used to find the angle between two vectors, is A dot B, that is 30, divided by root 90 and root 10, which were the magnitude of vectors A and vector B. So, this is 1. So, when cos theta 1, theta is either 0 and theta has to be 0. So theta is 0, that means A and B are parallel to each other. Next, just to create some space, next the question is that A and B are some two vectors, and magnitude of A and B are this 2 unit and 3 unit. If A and B are perpendicular to each other, find the magnitude of A plus B. So how will do it? So A square plus b square plus 2ab. Cos theta power half. We know that the vectors are parallel perpendicular to each other. This term reduces to 0. So a square plus b square is simply 4 plus 9 and square root, which is root 30. Next, we are given two vectors A and B. We have to add A and B. So adding A and B, so this is 2i minus 1, which is I, plus 2j, minus k minus k minus 2k. This particular question, A part is done. A plus B is 2i minus I plus 2j minus 2k. Parts B and C can be done by the viewer. So next we come to the last part of the vectors. So when we started with multiplication of a vector, we discuss that the vectors can be multiplied in two ways, first to get a scalar product and the next to get a vector product. So this cross product is actually a vector product, cross or vector product. So how it is defined? So the definition of cross product of two vectors is something like this. That is magnitude of A vector, magnitude of B vector, sine of the smaller angle between A vector and B vector, and the unit vector n cap. This unit vector n cap is given by right hand's through rule. It's a unit vector which is perpendicular to both A and B, and it is obtained by moving right hand. It is obtained by moving right hand from A vector towards, let's say, B vector was like this, towards B vector. So when the right hand, the fingers of the right hand are curled from the direction of A vector to the B vector, then our thumb shows the direction of the n cap. For example, A vector is in this direction and B vector is somewhere like this. So A cross B. since it's a cross product, we say cross, the A cross B, this is like this. Suppose this is direction of A vector and this is B vector, so A cross B, so this will be direction of n cap. So n cap, like any direction vector, is a 3D vector. So it can be in anywhere in space and would depend upon what are the directions of A and B, and would be always in a plane perpendicular to A and B. So what we have done is that n cap is a unit vector in direction perpendicular to plane containing A and B, and given by right hand skew rule. So here is an example of right hand skew rule. This is A vector, this is B vector. So A cross B, this is the direction of n cap, and therefore it also becomes direction of A cross B. The magnitude of A cross B is AB sine theta, and the direction is n cap. So next, let's say we want to write B cross A. So again, we would move our right hand in the direction from B vector to A vector. So our thumb would show the direction of B cross A. So as you can see in the figure, A cross B and B cross A are two vectors opposite to each other. So when these two vectors are opposite to each other and their magnitude is same, then we can say that they are opposite vectors. So this is what is written here. B cross A is opposite to direction of A cross B, but equal in magnitude. So A cross B is equal to minus B cross A. So now let's discuss a very fun way to find a cross product. So what we can do is that let's say A vector is in some direction and B vector is some other direction. So what we can do is that position our hand in the first vector, and let's say we want to slap in the direction from A to B. So if we take a slap in the direction from A to B, then our thumb would show the direction of A cross B. Now, since there is a sine theta involved, the angle between two equal vectors is zero, so A cross A becomes zero. So if two vectors are parallel or anti-parallel, then A cross B is zero. I cross I, J cross J, K cross K, all are zero. I cross J is K cap, J cross K is I cap, and K cross I is J cap. So this is something which can be remembered using this cycle. So what we do is that we draw I cap, J cap, and K cap, and we take a cycle in clockwise direction. So if we take I cross J, we get K cap. If we go J cross K, we get I cap. If we go K cross I, we get J cap. So this is what is written here. I cross J is K, J cross K is I, and K cross I is J. Next, if we want to go anti-clockwise in cycle, then just remember that you have to take a negative sign. So suppose you have to go K cross J. K cross J would give you minus I. K cross J is minus I. I cross K would give you minus J. I cross K is minus J. And K cross J would give you minus I. So here we have taken a small example. Want to multiply 2i with 3j. So 2 into 3 is 6. That is the magnitudes are multiplies as is. And I cross J is K. So this is how we find cross product of any two vectors. So if these vectors are 2D vectors, let's say some ai plus bj plus ci plus dj, then the I cap and J cap components can be added using these two rules, and we would get the cross product of those two vectors. So this was our lecture on vectors. Thank you.